Hello, my name is Stephen Lester, and welcome to HCM Microlessons. Today we're going to review a case when you look at the echocardiogram and notice that the walls of the heart are thick. And this patient will turn out to have Fabry's disease, a lysosomal storage disorder. So when you're reviewing an echocardiogram, and on the 2D images you appreciate that the walls of the heart are thick and you're considering a diagnosis of HCM, you must always keep at top of mind the possibility that this could be Fabry's disease. Because again, the 2D phenotype is the same. The walls of the heart are thick. And when you're working in an HCM clinic, in this example, men over the age of 40 presenting with an initial diagnosis of possible HCM, over 6% of these men ended up having Fabry's disease. Under the age of 40, a little less frequent, about 1.4 to 1.5% of these men ended up having Fabry's disease. It has important clinical implications because, of course, the correct diagnosis is important with respect to therapeutic intervention. As for Fabry's disease, a lysosomal storage disorder, there can be enzyme replacement or oral chaperone therapy, which may stabilize and for some even reverse some of the cardiovascular manifestations. So let's look at this 53-year-old man. No family history of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. He's NYHA functionally class 3 and has effort-related presyncope. Here we see the parasternal long axis view, very small left ventricular cavity and a robust, therefore, ejection fraction, but very low stroke volume. And we can appreciate that the walls of the heart are really quite thick. Measured here, the antroseptal wall thickness was 25 millimeters and the infralateral wall measured at 24 millimeters. So here on the left, we see the 2D apical four chamber view, and you can appreciate a marked concentric increase in left ventricular wall thickness. On the right, we see the apical three chamber view with color Doppler, and you can see that mosaic color flow pattern through the mid ventricle, suggesting mid ventricular obstruction. Now, when we place a continuous wave spectral Doppler profile through the mid ventricle, we appreciate this late peaking dagger-shaped velocity profile that stops at the aortic closure click. There's a clear IVRT, so this is not mitral regurgitation, and that the mid-ventricular peak instantaneous gradient at rest is 100 millimeters of mercury. So here on the left, again, we see that apical four-chamber view and appreciate that the walls of the heart are very thick. Again, could this be left ventricular hypertrophy? Could this be an infiltrative disorder? Is this a potential storage disease? On the right, we're looking at myocardial imaging, and we appreciate that the global longitudinal peak systolic strain is quite abnormal at minus 6%. But not only do we again look just at amplitude parameters of strain, but pattern recognition. And at this parametric bullseye display, we see that strain is abnormal in virtually all segments. Different than what we had seen in the microlesson of a patient with amyloidosis, where we saw an exaggerated apical sparing pattern, making our index of suspicion of an infiltrative disorder a little lower in this particular case. We often would continue with further imaging, frequently with MRI in these cases. For interest of time, I'll just say it corroborated the echomorphologic findings and did show some delayed enhancement at the LV lateral wall in addition to the septum at the RV insertion site. We went on for additional testing, particularly genetic testing, which showed an abnormality in the GLA gene, and serum alpha-galactosidase levels were quite low. So this patient now had a diagnosis of Fabry's disease, a lysosomal storage disease. With Fabry's disease, you see mutations in the GLA gene, which provides instructions for making an enzyme called alpha-galactosidase. Alpha-galactosidase is active in lysosomes and breaks down this fatty substance. And of course, if you don't have that enzyme to break down the fatty substance, it just sits in the cells swell, and the heart becomes thick. And hence my concept of saying these storage diseases are like the garbage disposals of the cells are really not working. In Fabry's disease, this is an X-linked disorder. It can affect women despite being X-linked. Mutations that decrease but do not eliminate the enzyme activity usually cause the milder later onset of disease that affects only the heart and kidneys. Some additional clinical manifestations. You may appreciate these corneal whirl-like opacifications. Cutaneously, you may see angiokeratomas. They can have progressive renal dysfunction, acroparesthesias, and anhidrosis. Now, although our patient did have Fabry's disease and we were aware of this and beginning treatment enzyme replacement therapy because of the marked symptoms and dramatic obstruction to outflow, patient did undergo a surgical myectomy. Here we see the pathologic specimen from the surgical myectomy. These are light microscopic features compatible with, as shown in the diagnostic comments from our pathologist, of a storage disease, including marked sarcoplasmic vacuolization. These are these white little circles pointed out by the yellow arrows. So this patient's thick walls were not related to hypertrophy secondary to something like HCM. It was not due to an infiltrative disorder like amyloidosis. This was due to a storage disease, in this case, Fabry's disease. Now, just out of interest, I wanted to share with you this image, courtesy of my friend, Dr. Freeman, of a man who also had Fabry's disease, and points out an interesting echocardiographic finding. That in this apical three-chamber view, what you can see, particularly along the antral septal segment, is a very hyper-refractile subendocardial border. It looks very white. And this is because the glycosphingolipid accumulation tends to be along the subendocardial border. Although not always present, when you identify this, this has reasonable test characteristics to suggest Fabry's disease. So the take-home message is, even though an individual may have an increase in left ventricular, sometimes right ventricular wall thickness, and in this case, there was midventricular obstruction and a significant midventricular gradient, this does not definitively mean this patient has hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. And we must be aware of and work through our differential diagnoses, whether there are other causes of left ventricular hypertrophy, whether they be endocrine or hemodynamic, an infiltrative disorder like amyloidosis, or in this example, a storage disease such as Fabry's disease. This ensures then that we make a prompt and correct diagnosis and then are able to provide the most appropriate and effective therapy for our patients.